Good morning, church. Good morning. I see some patriotic colors out there. That's pretty awesome. Those of you who might not know who I am, most of you I think do, but my name is Ed. You usually see me standing somewhere around here and sometimes back there in the choir, but I'm just excited that we can just get together this morning and just worship our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. We're focusing on his name this morning and who he is, the great I am, and his name, the only name. So let's stand together. Let's worship him.
Yours will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I seek, the only name that matters to me. Yours will be the friendship and affection I need to feel my Father smiling on me, the only name that matters to me. Yours is the name that saved me, mercy and grace, the power that forgave me. In your love is all I've ever needed. Yours will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I seek, the only name that matters to me. Yours is the name that saved me, mercy and grace, the power that forgave me. In your love is all I've ever needed. When I wake up in the land of glory, with the saints I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. Tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. La 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 la.
Sometimes I get myself in trouble when I have too much time to think. I was just thinking about the words of that song, When I wake up in the land of glory with all the saints, I will tell my story. This is the first free sermon. Don't wait till you get to glory to tell your story, church. We have a lost world out there that needs to hear about the name of Jesus, right? Well, good morning. Welcome to worship. That one was totally free. Excited to be here this morning. So grateful for Brother Ed and all of our praise and worship leaders. They do a fantastic job for us every week. Grateful for them and their ministry to us. If you're visiting with us, we're especially glad that you're here. Hopefully you'll find one of our visitor cards in the chair pocket in front of you. You can scan that QR code and fill it out online, or you can get pen and paper and pen and pencil, I guess you've already got the paper, and fill that out and drop it in one of the offering boxes as you leave. We'd be grateful for that. Sorry that you missed our senior pastor, Monty Geis. He is out on sabbatical still, and so please continue to pray for him and his family as they enjoy this time of refreshing as God rejuvenates him, I trust, and grateful for this opportunity for him to be away. So do be praying for him. Of course, it is also the 4th of July weekend, right? July 3rd. Tomorrow's a holiday. Thankful for all for that. Thankful to be in America. We're going to talk about that a little bit longer, a little bit later in the sermon. And so grateful for that. Just the blessing of being here in America. And so let's pray together at this point, and then we will continue to lift our praises to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful to be able to gather together as the body of Christ this morning and to worship you and to proclaim that name that is above every name. Oh, what a beautiful sound it is to hear the name of Jesus and think about all that he's done for us, that he has finished every task that needed to be done for us to live lives that are right with our Heavenly Father and can bring our Father honor and glory with our lives, that we can experience eternal life beginning right now because of what Christ has already done for us. So, Father, we rejoice in your redemptive plan, the way Christ came and executed that plan. And now on top of all that, we get the gift of the Holy Spirit filling our hearts and our lives to teach us and to transform us. And Lord, we trust that during this time of worship and singing our praises and praying our prayers and looking into your word, God, that you would use all of those things to shape and mold us as your children and to shape us more and more into the likeness of your Son, Jesus Christ. So, Father, help us to be open to your molding in our lives this morning. Shape us and transform us, we pray. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sing. It's about Jesus. He is I am.
There's no space that his love can reach. There's no place where we can find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Take me in with your arms spread wide. Take me in like an orphan child. Never let go, never leave my side. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on. I am. Love like this. So my God to find, I am overwhelmed with a joy divine. Love like this sets our hearts on fire. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I'm holding on, I am
holding on to you.
I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I'm holding on, I am.
Let's all stand, everyone.
This is my resurrection song.
This is my hallelujah, come. This is why it's to you I run. This is my resurrection song. This is my hallelujah, come. This is why it's to you I run. There's no space that His love can't reach. There's no place where He can find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I'm holding on. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on.
Yes, He is. He's I am. And He's also stronger. Lord, You are stronger. Sin is broken. You have saved us. It is written, Christ is risen. Jesus, You are Lord of all.
Be lifted higher, be lifted higher. are stronger. Sin is broken. You have saved me. It is written. Christ is risen. Jesus, you are Lord of all. You are stronger. You are stronger. Sin is broken. You have saved me. It is written. Christ is risen. Jesus, you are Lord of all.
Amen. You may be seated.
Trevor. All right, if you've got your Bibles, we're going to conclude our portion of this sermon series in the Gospel of John in John chapter 8. I've entitled this message, The Great I Am, as Jesus proclaims at the end of this passage that he is I Am, thus proclaiming himself to be God himself. And it's interesting to me, we, especially those of us who love sports, we love to have debates about who is the greatest, right? We do this all the time. Who is the greatest? Is it Michael Jordan or is it LeBron James? Who is the greatest? Yeah. Of course, everybody knows it's Michael Jordan, but that's okay if you think otherwise. Jack Nicklaus or Tiger Woods? I hear there's a debate in soccer about whether it's Messi or Ronaldo. I don't really know anything about soccer, so I don't know. Then there's the classic debate of boxers versus briefs. Now, of course, there are some debates when it comes to greatness that have really been settled. You know, you talk about quarterbacks in the NFL. Unfortunately, it's Tom Brady. Just have to admit that. Heavyweight boxer, Muhammad Ali, obviously the greatest. Swimming, Michael Phelps. That man's got more gold medals hanging around his neck. He probably can't even stand up with them all. Think about the greatest sprinter of all time, Usain Bolt, the fastest human being of all time. Absolutely amazing. Women's tennis, you have Serena Williams, just a phenomenal athlete, has won so many championships, so many titles. Hockey, got Wayne Gretzky. Nobody quite comes close to him. Gymnastics, Simone Biles, absolutely changed the sport of women's gymnastics. They changed the way they scored because of her. Because the things that she was doing, the tricks that she was able to do, no one else could do. And they were afraid that people trying to emulate her would hurt themselves. So they changed the way they scored. What an incredible athlete. Now, of course, my favorite all-time greatest is not even a person. But it's a racehorse. Secretariat, the greatest racehorse of all time. My father loved Secretariat so much, there was a picture of Secretariat in our house. I still watch that Belmont Stakes. Probably every 5 or 6 months, I'll just go on YouTube and watch that race where Secretariat broke the track record by over 2 seconds, a record that almost 30 years ago still stands. Almost 50 years ago, still stands. Oh, that was a long time ago. You think about all the track and field records that have been broken over the last 50 years, but that horse still ran the fastest race ever. Absolutely amazing. Of course, we have other debates about what's the greatest movie, who's the greatest actor or actress. Some of our staff were debating what is the greatest fast food meal that you could build. I don't know why we were wasting our time on that, but on and on it goes. Of course, as we think about July 4th tomorrow, what is the greatest country? America. God has used the United States of America, I believe, to do more good in the world than any other country on the face of the planet. And so as you get up tomorrow and celebrate our independence as we overthrew the British to claim our independence, thank the Lord that you have the blessing of living here in the United States. Now, we've got problems here in the U.S., right? Every country's got problems. We've got problems. But there's a reason millions of people still risk their lives every year trying to get here, legally or illegally, because of the hope and the opportunity and the promise that comes from living in the United States of America. So rejoice that God has blessed you with the blessing of living here. So who is the greatest? Well, Jesus Christ is the greatest of all the greatest, because he, in this passage we're going to look at, proclaims himself to be God. Now, that is either a statement of a lunatic or it is the truth. Now, those who heard him make this statement, they thought he was a lunatic. They picked up stones. They were going to kill him for proclaiming who he really is. That's what we're going to be looking at this morning. Unfortunately, those who heard Jesus proclaim to be the I Am didn't really understand who he was. They rejected him. They wanted to kill him for it. I pray our response will be different this morning. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, in this idea of greatness, it's so easy to fall into that trap of just being caught up in the excitement of who's great and who's not. Even the disciples debated about which one of them would be the greatest in the kingdom. Well, there's only one great one in the kingdom, and that's Jesus Christ, our Lord. So, Father, as we look into your word this morning, I pray that you would speak to our hearts as we think about the promise of eternal life that Jesus gives us in this passage, as we think about his proclamation of being the great I Am. Lord, I pray that for those of us who already know you, Lord, it would be such an incredible encouragement to us as we think about who you are, what you've done for us. And Father, if there are those here that haven't realized or haven't accepted what Christ has done, they don't have that assurance of eternal life, I pray that today would be the day of salvation for them. As they turn from their sins, trust in the finished work of Christ, Lord, we pray that that would be the case for them today. Father, we're again so grateful for your word, grateful for what it teaches us, and we pray that you'll use it to grow us and mature us and transform us. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you've got your Bible there, John 8, we'll begin in verse 48. 48 through 51. The Jews answered him, "Are we not right in saying you are a Samaritan and have a demon?" Jesus answered, "I do not have a demon, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. Yet I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it, and he is the judge. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death." Jesus gives this incredible promise right here. He promises eternal life. He promises that those who keep his word will never experience death. What an incredible promise. Now, as the dialogue goes back and forth with these Jews that Jesus is talking about, they don't fully grasp, they don't fully understand exactly what he's talking about here. And of course, this debate begins, we're picking up kind of at the tail end of an ongoing dialogue. As we said a few weeks ago, Jesus has been talking to these people, and this group of people, the scripture said, I believe it's back in verse 31, that they believed him. They believed Jesus. But it doesn't say they believed in him. So they believed some of the things that Jesus had been saying, but they had not placed the full weight of their faith on him as Lord and Savior. So Jesus is not willing to allow them to stay in some state of belief that falls short of saving faith. And so he begins to push them to make a decision about who he really is. Previously, he has said that they are children of their father, the devil. That's a great way to win people over. You are children of your father, who happens to be Satan. And so Jesus is pushing them to recognize their true spiritual condition. And we pick it up with them responding to that. And they say, Yeah, well, Jesus, you're a Samaritan. Now, for a Jew, there's not much of a worse insult that you could give. The Samaritans were those who lived a little bit to the north, and during one of the exiles, they had remained and they had intermarried with the Gentiles, and so the Jews really looked down upon the Samaritans. They viewed them as half-breeds, not worthy of associating with, not worthy of God's redemption. And so to call a Jew a Samaritan was one of the greatest insults that you could hurl at them. And so Jesus told them that their father is the devil. Oh yeah, well, you're a Samaritan. So they throw it right back at him. But on top of that, they say that he also has a demon. Incredible that they would proclaim the Son of the living God has a demon. They really did not understand who they were talking to. They claimed that he has a demon. Now, Jesus, in response to this in verse 49, he doesn't even address the Samaritan claim. This kind of mudslinging that they were digging down into, they had fallen to such a low level of communication, there was no point in even responding to that. But he does deny the fact that he has a demon, as if he needed to. He tells them that he doesn't have a demon, that he, in fact, honors his father. The father that they claim as their God, if they really knew who the father was, they would honor the father as well by honoring Jesus. Jesus says that he honors the father, but you dishonor me. Again, drawing this contrast that if they really knew who the father was, if they really wanted to live for the father and to honor the father, then they would recognize the son when he came. But because they hadn't recognized him, they are dishonoring Jesus, calling him names, calling him a Samaritan, claiming he has a demon. Well, in verse 50, Jesus talks a little bit more about this idea of honor and also about judgment. Jesus says that he does not seek his own glory. Now, if there was anyone that could claim the glories of the people of the earth, it would be Jesus. Think about all the things that he's done in his life. He's made the blind to see. He's made the lame to walk. He's caused the dead to rise. He could boast more than anyone, but he never sought his own glory because he was confident in the fact that his Father was glorifying him and would ultimately glorify him as he is lifted up on the cross of Calvary. But he says there is one who seeks the glory. Speaking of the Heavenly Father, that the Father seeks the glory of all those that he has created, all of us, all of creation honors and glorifies the Creator, except for us. We're the ones who have failed in our job, our responsibility, our privilege and blessing of getting to return the glory to our Father. And Jesus says something else about the Father here. He says that he is the judge. It is interesting to me that Jesus would point that out in this context, because by dishonoring Jesus, by rejecting Jesus, they are putting themselves in grave spiritual danger of judgment. There is a judge who is going to judge, and the Father is going to judge, and it just highlights the spiritual danger that these people are in by rejecting Jesus as the Son of God. They are rejecting him and dishonoring him. And then in verse 51, he says these words that absolutely blows their mind. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death. It's interesting to me that death is something that can be a very fearful thing for people. So thinking about things that we're afraid of, I did a quick search and found some of the things that people are the most afraid of. What do you think is number one on that list? Public speaking. Yep. So anybody want to come on up here and take a turn? The second one was heights. So you're publicly speaking on a platform. So it just gets better and better. Bugs and snakes. Anybody afraid of snakes? There's only one kind of snake, right? one good kind of snake, and that's a dead snake. Fear of drowning. I feel like I'm a pretty good swimmer. I don't really worry about that one much. The sight of blood and needles. And I felt some anxiety rising up just saying that. You know, there are some people who, when they're getting a shot or giving blood, they have to look away. I always want to know what's happening to me. I have to watch. I don't know why that is. It seems a little weird sometimes, but I want to see what they're doing when they stick that needle in my arm. Like somehow I'm going to help them find the vein. I don't know what it is about that. But a lot of people are afraid of that. A lot of people are afraid of enclosed spaces. They're claustrophobic. I'm still working on a plan for how to lock Pastor Monty in the elevator because he is claustrophobic. They're afraid of flying. Now, let's be honest. It's not really the flying that we're afraid of. It's the not flying. That's the problem. People are afraid of strangers. Well, some people are stranger than others, so I kind of get that. But then it goes off the rails at that point. The next one on the list was zombies. I'm like, come on. Really? Well, zombies are pretty strange, so I guess that's part of the problem. Afraid of the dark. Afraid of clowns. Now, I have to say, I'm not a fan of the clowns. There's something a little creepy about that. And the last one was they're afraid of ghosts. You notice what's not on that list? Death. We are so afraid of death, we don't want to think about it ever. Even when we're asked to list the things that we're afraid of, we don't want to talk about death. And yet Jesus comes along and says, if you keep my word, you will never see death. What an incredible promise that Jesus has made to us. You will never see death. Earlier in John chapter 5, verse 24, he said this. Again, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life. When you put your faith and trust in Christ, there's a transaction that occurs where death is completely taken off the table for us as children of God. Now, you may say, well, hold on a second. People still die, right? At a funeral of one of our dear, sweet church ladies this past Friday. Lived a wonderful 86 years. Now has seen her Savior face to face, Miss Margie Freeman. So grateful for her life, her faith and service. She served the Lord so faithfully. Now she has heard those words that every follower of Christ longs to hear. Well done, good and faithful servant. And at the funeral, I said, we celebrate her life because she is not dead. Her physical body has died, but her spirit lives on. That's what Jesus is talking about here. When you come to faith in Christ, your eternity is settled because of what Christ has already done for us. We will never see death. Now, of course, there's the physical death, which comes for all of us at some point. None of us will live forever in this physical body that God has given us, unless the Lord Jesus returns before our earthly death. But there is also a spiritual death, a separation from God for all eternity. And that's the death Jesus is talking about here. You will never see that death if you are a follower of Christ, if you keep his word, if you've placed your faith and trust in him. What an incredible promise. In John 11, Jesus' good friend Lazarus has died. And Jesus goes to minister to the family, and ultimately he's going to raise Lazarus back to life in miraculous fashion. And he's speaking with Martha, and in John 11, 25 and following, Martha has said that she knows that her brother will be raised again on the last day. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? He asked her. And she said, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. That promise of eternal life that Jesus gives in this passage in John 8:51, it is a promise that we can trust with all of our heart. When we place our faith and trust in Christ, we make this transition from death to life. We are spiritually dead before we come to faith in Christ. But once we've made that decision, once we've surrendered our life to Him, we are made alive spiritually in Christ. And He is in us. What an incredible blessing, church. Don't miss that. That Jesus has done everything that is required for us to have eternal life. If we will turn from our sins, trust in what Christ has done for us, ask Him to forgive us, we can have that promise of eternal life. Well, the people that Jesus was talking to, they did not understand what He was saying. They didn't get. And I understand that in part, because He's not yet died for their sins. He's not been resurrected yet. And so it's a little more complicated for them, but let's look at what they said in verse 52 and 53. Jesus said, if you keep my word, you will never see death. The Jews said to him, now we know that you have a demon. Abraham died, as did the prophets. Yet you say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who died? And the prophets died. Who do you make yourself out to be? Ah, now we finally got to the right question, church. Jesus, who do you make yourself out to be? That is the most important question any human being will ever answer in their lives. Who is Jesus? They ask Jesus. They are so confused over this idea that you could live forever in eternity. They don't understand how it's possible that you could never see death, that you could never experience death. And they went back to Abraham, who they'd been talking about a lot in this dialogue. Abraham, the father of the Jewish nation, their faith hero that they look to for inspiration. And they talk about Abraham. Abraham, who trusted God. Abraham, who believed the promises of God. Abraham, who, when God said, Abraham, I want you to leave your home and your family and go. Go where? To a place that I will show you at some point in the future. Abraham packed up all his stuff and went by faith. When Abraham was 100 years old and his wife Sarah was 90, God said, you two, 190, y'all are going to have a baby. And that promise came true, and then God said to Abraham, I want you to sacrifice your son Isaac, this child of the promise, back to me. And so Abraham takes Isaac up on the side of that mountain, binds him up, lays him on the altar, raises the knife, ready to sacrifice his son, trusting in the promise of God that Isaac would be resurrected even if he killed him. That's the kind of faith that Abraham demonstrated. But Abraham never promised anyone eternal life. In fact, Abraham died and had been dead for over 2,000 years when Jesus is talking about this. So they're saying, you're here promising eternal life? Abraham never made such incredible claims. The prophets of old that came and heard God and listened to God and relayed His messages to the people, they never made these claims that if you keep my word, you will have eternal life. Abraham died. The prophets died. Jesus, who do you make yourself out to be? Are you greater than Abraham? To which we say, yes, He is greater than Abraham. He is greater than the prophets. Unfortunately, these folks could not see His greatness. Are you greater than Abraham? Are you greater than the prophets? Who do you make yourself out to be? I loved what D.A. Carson said in his commentary on this passage. In reflecting on this question, who do you make yourself out to be, Jesus? He said this, Jesus does not make himself or exalt himself to be anything. Far from it. He is the most obedient and dependent of men, uniquely submissive to the Father. While Jesus could have made much of who he was the perfect, humble servant following the Lord. But he also had to proclaim his true identity. He could not keep that secret because people had to know who he was in order to trust him and put their faith in him. So in verses 54 through 59, we see what happens when Jesus begins to reveal who he really is. They ask the question, who do you make yourself out to be? And Jesus is going to answer them. In verse 54, Jesus answered, if I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me, of whom you say he is our God. But you have not known him. I know him. If I were to say I don't know him, I would be a liar like you. Again, he's great at winning people over with his kind words. He continues, but I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. So the Jews said to him, you are not yet 50 years old, and you have seen Abraham? Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. So they picked up stones to throw at him. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. So in verse 54, Jesus begins by proclaiming his humility. He talks about the fact that he does not seek his own glory. Jesus didn't need to seek his own glory because he was confident that his Father was the one who would glorify him. While Jesus was worthy of all of our glory, while he was due all of our glory, he was okay with the fact that the people weren't glorifying him. He was perfectly humble in all that he said and did. We are often perplexed when we see true humility because we see it so infrequently. Humility is something that is it's very slippery. It's hard to grasp. Because that very moment where you think, you know, I was really humble in that situation. Well, that's actually pride. And so humility is something that when you think you have it, you probably don't. But we're all called upon to be humble, to think about others before ourselves. And here's the reality. We can never be humble when we're thinking about ourselves. And we think about ourselves all the time. We think about ourselves. We take pictures of ourselves. We post them online so that our fake Facebook friends can see us. You know, so much of this life is all about us. But Jesus' life was all about serving his heavenly Father, bringing glory to the Father. When I think about my life, when you think about your life, whose glory are you after? Jesus was only seeking the Father's glory. And that's where true humility can be found. We see it so infrequently that it amazes us when we see someone who is truly humble. And because of Jesus' humility, his Father was giving him glory upon glory for who he was. In verse 53, Jesus says that he keeps his Father's word, talking about his obedience. Jesus was not only humble in his relationship with the Father, but he was perfectly obedient in everything that he said and did. His desire was only to do those things that the Father wanted him to do. And of course, earlier in a message a couple of weeks ago, we talked about the fact that Jesus challenged these same people, which one of you convicts me of sin? Proclaiming his sinlessness, and here proclaiming that he always keeps his Father's word. And of course, it is essential that Jesus be perfect, that he have never sinned, that he be the spotless Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. If Jesus didn't always keep his Father's word, then he would have been disqualified from being that sacrificial lamb that we all needed. And so Jesus is telling them, look at my humility. See that I am who I say I am. Look at the way I always keep my Father's word. It is proof of who I am. Now, of course, in verse 56, the people respond to that. And they say, no, Jesus said to them, your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. That is a strange and perplexing verse of scripture to me. Abraham, who died over 2,000 years ago, saw Jesus' day. I don't know what that means. I appreciated John Piper in his sermon on this passage of scripture because he said, nobody knows what it means. He said, you read three different commentaries on this, they have three different opinions about what it means. But the interesting thing is, it was not a foreign concept to the hearers that Jesus was speaking to. This idea that Abraham had had a vision into the age of the Messiah was pretty commonly held by the Jewish rabbis. They really talked about Abraham in Genesis 15:12, where God causes him to fall into a deep sleep right before he makes this covenant with him. And perhaps there is where Abraham had this vision into the future. Or they talk about Genesis 17:17, where, again, Abraham at 100 years old, Sarah at 90 years old, is told by God that you two are going to have a son, and Abraham falls down laughing. And they say, the Jewish rabbis say, this is an example of incredible joy that Abraham experienced on realizing that through his son, soon to be Isaac, all the way forward to the Messiah, that he has had this prophetic vision, and that's why he's laughing. It's just overwhelming joy in that moment. Well, that doesn't really make any sense to me, because the next words out of Abraham's mouth are about Ishmael and wanting God to bless him. So that doesn't make any sense to me. But as John Piper said, it really doesn't matter when or if Abraham had this vision, right? Well, he had it because Jesus said he did, so I guess that part does matter. But when he had it, we don't know, and it really doesn't matter. Because it happened, and that's not really the point that Jesus is trying to get at here. In verse 57, they talk back to Jesus about that, and they tell him, you're not even 50 years old. You're telling us you've seen Abraham? This doesn't make any sense to us. You're not old enough to have seen Abraham. You're not even old enough to have seen Abraham Lincoln, much less... Oh, wait, that's a different time period. Never mind. So Abraham died over 2,000 years ago. Jesus is still a young man. He's only in his early 30s. Jesus was not even old enough to be considered one of the elders in the community. And so they are looking at him saying, you're too young. You're claiming to have seen Abraham. Abraham saw your day. None of this makes any sense to us. Well, the only way it makes sense is what Jesus said next in verse 58. Where again he says, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. This incredible proclamation of divinity that Jesus makes right here. Jesus did not say, before Abraham was, I was, which would just mean his preexistence, that he was there when Abraham was, that he was somehow a contemporary of Abraham, that they saw each other. He said, before Abraham was, I am, which takes you right back to Exodus 3:14, where God spoke out of the burning bush to Moses when Moses said, who shall I say sent me? I am that I am, was the response out of that burning bush. Jesus is saying, that voice out of the burning bush, that's me. Jesus has just blown them away by claiming to be God himself. And who can make the promise to give eternal life to people except for God himself? And so he makes this bold proclamation that he is in fact God, saying that he is eternal, saying that he is the the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, he is making this bold proclamation in answer to their question, who do you make yourself out to be? Well, Jesus tells them who he is. He is the great I Am. And they have no idea how to respond to that except to pick up stones and try to kill him. And of course, they pick up stones because they do know the law. The penalty for blasphemy is stoning. And what greater blasphemy could there be than proclaiming yourself to be God? If I were to stand up here and say to you that I am God, I hope you wouldn't pick up stones to kill me, but I hope you'd get the heck out of here. Because that is a lie upon lies upon lies. But when Jesus made that claim, it was the truth. Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. Jesus makes this incredible proclamation. He has promised eternal life. Only the Son of God, only God himself could fulfill that promise. Only he could give eternal life. And why can he give eternal life? Because he's headed to the cross. He's going to be gloriously raised again. He's going to defeat hell, death, and the grave so that the grave can no longer hold his children. The great I Am says, I can give you eternal life because I am going to make payment for all of your sins. And if you put your faith and your trust in me and believe the words that I'm saying to you, believe who I am, you will experience that promise. You will have eternal life because Jesus is the great I Am. Amen, church? Let's pray together. Father, we do rejoice over who you are, just your incredible redemptive plan. We're so grateful for that plan that you devised before you even created any of this. From eternity past, you had in your mind, Father, what you were going to do to redeem your people. And we're grateful that Christ was willing to come and humble himself to become a babe wrapped in flesh, to become one of us, even to be humbled to the cross, so that he could make payment for us as the perfect sacrificial Lamb of God. Father, I pray that if we're here this morning and we've placed our faith and trust in you, Lord, that we have been encouraged and blessed by this word this morning. The promise of eternal life that you've given us, the reality that Christ is capable of making such a promise because he holds the keys to death himself. He has already defeated death. There is nothing for us to fear when it comes to death who have placed our faith and trust in Christ. So, Lord, we rejoice in that incredible truth. And, Father, we're so grateful for who you are, Jesus, the great Lamb of God who came to take away the sin of the world. What an incredible promise that we have because of who you are and what you've done. Father, I pray for those that might be here that aren't quite sure if they've received that promise of eternal life. Lord, I pray that they would, this very moment, repent of their sins, believe on Christ, believe that he is who he said he is, believe that he's made payment for their sins and accept him as their Lord and Savior. Lord, as we transition into this time of invitation, if there are those who have made that decision or want to talk more about what it means to follow Christ, I pray that they would come and speak with one of our pastors here at the front. Lord, if there are those that need to join the fellowship here at Swift Creek, let them come and begin that process as well. Lord, if there's a burden that someone's been carrying that they just need to come to these steps and make this an altar and lay that down before you, Lord, I pray they would have the freedom to do that as well. Lord, we just want you to have your way with us in this moment as we sing one last song to you, as we contemplate and consider the things that we've sung and prayed and heard this morning. Lord, we want this to be a time that honors you as well. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness saw through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim. Is the victory.
We took our students, 20 students, and six adults to Atlanta, Georgia this past week in a suburb called Clarkston on a mission trip. And Clarkston is home to one of the densest populations of resettled refugees in America. It's home to 90 unreached people groups. And so our students were serving with the North American Mission Board and Send Relief in ministries that are ongoing, that have been there for years, and serving them reach many of these refugees and their families and kids with the love of Christ and the hope of the gospel. And so we got to serve. Our students did so well. They were so eager, and they were loving, and they were just wanting to be useful. Great unity in our group. So we just had a great trip, and they had lots of gospel conversations. We served over 260 people. And so it was just a great trip. You would have been really proud of our group and our students, and God's really at work in their life. And so, yeah, you can play. Okay, now a couple of announcements. We have deacon nominations. If you'd like to nominate a deacon, there are forms on the back, little pub table right there with the tithes and offerings, a little form to pick up. You can nominate a deacon. Those are due July 17th. Please turn those in. We take each of those very seriously each time we nominate our new deacons. So July 17th to turn those in. Next announcement is for the men. So every guy in here, listen, all right? We have a very exciting and important event coming up, okay? It is called the Way of Escape Men's Dinner. Okay, it's on July 17th, which is a Sunday night. It is a dinner and fellowship to help us be better equipped and strengthened to continue our fight against sexual sin and temptation. Okay, we are going to have Dr. Chuck Lawless, who's one of my favorite professors from Southeastern. He will be here that night. He'll be teaching us on this very important topic. Chuck's a great brother in the faith. He loves the Lord. And when he talks, you better have a pen and a paper in hand, because he's going to say something convicting, challenging to strengthen you, okay? This is a night for every guy in the church from sixth grade and up, okay? We want all the men to be there, no matter where you are in this fight, whether you're having victory over it or you're enslaved to sexual sin, we want you to be there, to be encouraged with the hope of Christ, to strengthen other brothers in their faith. So please come. It'll be great fellowship, if anything else. $10 to pay for this food speaker. And you will be blessed and strengthened to get the ball rolling on this conversation, okay? So that's July 17th, Sunday night, 5 p.m. Sign up for that. And then lastly, we have a pastor's study, which is going to begin the following Wednesday after that, July 20th. We'll run for 4 weeks through August the 10th. And the pastor's study is called A World of Ideas Versus the Gospel. And so for 4 weeks, we're going to look at other ideas that are not the true gospel. We're going to look at the prosperity gospel. We're going to look at individualism. We're going to look at cults like Mormonism and Jehovah's Witness. And then we're going to look at Catholicism and look at how they compare to the true gospel. And then equip you, hopefully, to then share the gospel with those you know in your life that hold those views. Okay, Pastor Brian and I will be leading that study. That begins July 20th, Wednesday night at 6:30 in the Fellowship Hall. So I really hope you'll be here for that. All right? With that, if you'll stand, we'll be dismissed with a word of prayer. And Pastor Brian will be in this back corner. If you're a guest, he has a gift for you, and we will be dismissed. Let's pray together. Father, we come to you now in the name of Christ, by the power of your Spirit, Lord, and we just thank you for the amazing truth that we heard, that Jesus Christ is the great I am. Lord, that before Abraham was, I am, Christ says. God, what an amazing reality. Lord, you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning, the end, the first, in the last. Let us now go live as though that is a reality in our life, that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He will never change. Our lives change every day. They will change this week, but Christ will remain the same. And let us hold steadfastly to him through all of life's struggles this week. And God, bring us back next week to worship you. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed.